Welcome back to The Morning Show here on Arise News. Joining us now is Ojy Okpe with stories trending around the world. Hello, Ojy. How was your weekend?
Dr. Bati, my weekend was
fantastic. I hope it was not a case of party after party.
Why does it have to be party? I went to church, Dr. Bati. I was praying. I had night vigil. Good morning, Adeswa.
Yeah, how are you, Ojy? I'm fine, thank you.
Great. And good morning to you, viewers. We begin What's Trending Today in Nigeria. The national president of the Academic Staff Union of Universities, Professor Biodun Ogunyemi, has decried the recruitment system at the university, stating that many teachers were not qualified to teach. The president said this at the News Agency of Nigeria Forum in Abuja on Sunday. He also added that it was not a crime for lecturers to teach in two different universities and encouraged sabbatical. The professor blamed the poor attention that students get from lecturers to the poor learning environment across universities and to the increasing population of students, adding that the union will continue to advocate for the restoration, the resuscitation, and the repositioning of the university systems. I mean, it's great that he's continuing to advocate for this. I mean, I think it's really just a whole overhaul of the recruitment system. He claimed that, obviously, a lot of the teachers at the universities got into the universities through political interference and that politics of the university
has really done a lot of damage. Well, if the president of ASUU is saying that, I want to assume that he knows what he's talking about.
Correct.
Biodun Ogunyemi was my colleague, you know, more than two decades ago. At Olabisi, at Ogun State University, as it was then known. And later it became Ogun State University. And the two of us were also members of the ASUU Collective, the original founders, and he was part of that team. And he's gone from there to be professor, dean, and president of ASUU.
Yes.
So he stayed long enough in the university system to know what goes on.
Correct.
And if indeed there are persons within the university system who are not qualified to teach, then that's a very serious disclosure, because
very
it speaks to the quality of teaching, the quality of training that our university graduates, you know, have. And you know, the National Universities Commission, which is the body that is given the responsibility to maintain quality assurance and standards within the university system, has had, you know, during its visitations to many of these universities, to either recommend that certain university teachers, you know, should be downgraded, or that, you know, certain university teachers do not have the appropriate qualification, or that, you know, certain departments do not meet the appropriate quota. The minimum qualification for teaching in a university is a PhD. The Americans have a different system. You know, you may be highly experienced, and you bring, you know, that meeting between town and gown to enrich the process. But for persons who are not qualified to be recruited as a result of political interference, that's dangerous. I was a member of the governing council of the, you know, Olabisi Onabanjo for 4 years, and I was chair of the establishment committee. And at some point, we needed to do a rationalization of staff, not even at the level of the academics, but also at the level of, you know, ordinary staff, non-academic staff. So it's a problem that will need to be addressed, and NUC, you know, may have to engage the president of ASUU to say, okay, give us more information about these people who are not qualified.
Correct.
But again, you know, Biodun Ogunyemi was talking about IPs, which
yes,
I think is a major controversy between ASUU and government. And he was saying that they had recommended an alternative, you know, what he called an alternative solution.
Yes.
Now, why is it that the ASUU and the Office of the Auditor General have not been able to agree on that, because we were told by both parties that, you know, they're open to negotiations. And then he said there's no faction of ASUU. Well, and I asked him, is he aware that there's a body called the Congress of Nigerian Academics, who on the issue of IPs, you know, has also said that, look, they don't share the view of ASUU.
Interesting. I love the fact that we are all identifying these challenges, because this comes as the Minister of Employment and Labour, Dr. Chris Ngige, had only last week said a lot of Nigerian graduates are not employable. And now President of ASUU is saying we don't have the qualified teachers in school. It's interesting that we're all identifying these challenges. What are we doing about it should be the focus now. So we do know the problem. We should tackle it.
Yes, absolutely. I agree with you. Still in Nigeria, the chairman of Nigerians in the Diaspora Commission, Mrs. Abike Dabiri-Erawa, over the weekend said that the commission was seeking an amendment of the electoral law to enable more than 20 million Nigerians living abroad to vote in the country's general election. Mrs. Erawa said that Nigerians living abroad were contributing enormous resources to the national development, with an estimate of over $25 billion contributed in 2018. The commission stated that they are now working with the National Assembly to amend the country's Electoral Act to accommodate Nigerians in the diaspora. A great statement. I remember last year I saw a petition on change.org with over, I believe, like 2,000 signatures petitioning for this to include, you know, Nigerians in diaspora to vote. And I think that the fact that the commission is now working with the National Assembly to change that act, I think, is a great development. Other countries in Africa have the capacity to do that. I don't know why Nigerians are not allowing
electronic voting.
Well, yes, but what Abike Dabiri-Erawa is expressing really has been the concern of Nigerians, a group called Nigerians in Diaspora Organization, NIDO. They are in Canada, they are in Europe, they are in the United States, and they have been saying since 1999 that we cannot have a democratic process in Nigeria that excludes people, and that the fact that some people live abroad does not mean that they do not have a stake. And we have seen, in fact, instances where Nigerians in diaspora seem to be even more concerned, more enlightened, because of their exposure.
And their remittances each year are substantiated.
And they say they want to have a say, you know, in the choice of who leads Nigeria. But the question that others have raised is that, yes, this may be the standard thing in the U.S., in other countries, whereby in their embassies, people go and vote wherever they may live in the world. Even soldiers, the military, who are on foreign assignments, they vote in U.S. elections. But as Nigeria reached that stage, we have the system in place to ensure that diaspora voting will not become a vehicle for rigging election and bringing, you know, fantastic figures. But definitely, you know, people in diaspora, they have a right to say that they should be heard. And now that there is a diaspora organization with a director general, you know, I think Abike Dabiri-Erawa is perfectly in order to express the concern of our compatriots who are outside and who are very keen about the governance process in Nigeria.
Absolutely. Well, let's take our final story in the U.S. President Donald Trump's impeachment raised a lot of attention across the globe. The last U.S. president to be impeached was Bill Clinton in 1998. Users on social media have shared a video comparing the two presidents' impeachment speech that went viral over the weekend. Let's take a listen.
They don't even have any crime. This is the first impeachment where there's no crime. I say, tell me what I did, please.
I have accepted responsibility for what I did wrong in my personal life.
Yesterday, I sent Pelosi a letter denouncing and condemning her party's outrageous abuse of power. That's what it is.
And I have invited members of Congress to work with us to find a reasonable, bipartisan, and proportionate response.
The radical left in Congress is consumed with hatred and envy and rage. You see what's going on. I'll tell you, these people are crazy.
We must get rid of the poisonous venom of excessive partisanship, obsessive animosity, and uncontrolled anger.
Three Democrats went over to our side. No Republicans. It's unheard of.
I thank the few brave Republicans who withstood enormous pressure to stand with them.
What they put my family through is a disgrace, and they ought to be ashamed.
I thank the millions upon millions of American citizens who have expressed their support and their friendship to Hillary, to me, to our family.
And I'm fighting for you, and I love doing it with everything that I have. And I will never, ever stop.
I want the American people to know today that I am still committed to working with people of good faith and goodwill of both parties to do what's best for our country.
I could not stop laughing.
Let me just say, one was presidential, the other wasn't. Go figure.
I mean, I think they think
speaks for itself. You know, I mean, the contrast is so sharp.
Yeah. It is sharp.
It's so striking. One president, despite the fact that every president has his own style,
right.
I keep saying that. One president having a mental and emotional meltdown, and the other one, calm, dignified, well-composed,
well-written
calm,
speech
sober,
as well. I always wonder who writes his speeches, Donald
no,
Trump.
It went off script. I don't think it was a script there.
I don't think that was
no
a script.
There's no way you can be going out to address the public and not be composed in any manner whatsoever, Donald Trump. He's amazing.
Anyway, thank you very much, Ojy.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.